God's will with you today, and let us offer the prayer before we begin. Dear Heavenly Father, we love you, and thank you so much for your mercy and grace, so profound and abounding and everlasting. Father, we're always changing, we're shadows, but your unchanging love always keeps us alive. Father, at this time we pray that may we give this song from the bottom of our heart. May this will be our confession and resolution. And let us all live with joyful sound and praise and thanksgiving in our lives so that we can be victorious in the end times. We pray this in the name of Jesus with thanksgiving. Amen.
Somebody be, oh, 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 자, 우리 찬송가 512장 내주 되신 주를 참 사랑하고 찬양하시고 예배드리도록 하겠습니다.
Good evening and welcome to the Covenant Torches live broadcast this Wednesday evening. as we do on Wednesdays, we have a prayer session and we have a Bible study. So first, let me read off the names I have for our prayer list and what we need to pray for, and we can add to it. Continue to pray all these each week. We need to pray for the covenant of the Torch Church. We need to pray for the redemption history, let it be taught around the world. Pray for Barrett Seminary and our international recognition, outreach, and accreditation. Pray for the continued recovery of David Murmer from his fall. Pray for our new missionary, Julia Santiago, she thought she was going to be going to Mexico, but she's waiting on a visa now before she goes on a trip. So pray for her. Pray for those in danger's way from this hurricane coming from Louisiana, Mississippi, Florida. It seems like they've got a bullseye on them, that the hurricanes keep going right in that direction. So pray for them. Pray for Elder Barry's wife. She's battling gout in her feet. Pray that she'll be walking and she'll be running around here shortly. Anyone we need to add? Okay, Barbara, I guess they had an incident with COVID-19 in the store, and she had to take a test, and she hasn't got her results back yet. So pray that the results come back negative so she can go back to work. Anyone else?
Pray for all those that don't have or lose work right now. They can't work because of
COVID-19. Okay. Pastor saying pray for all those that are having trouble in times now because they can't work and they can't afford to pay their bills. We just need to pray to God and put it in His hands and let Him take care of it. Amen. So I'll raise our hands up. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. Father God, we thank you for the day that you've given us to come into your house tonight, Father, and to preach His precious word, Father. And Father, as we go forward, Father, we ask that you watch over David Murmer, Father. Heal him up, Father. Let him be good as new, Father. And Father, we pray for the Barrett Seminary School, Father, and accreditation, Father God. Father, we pray for redemption history. Let it be taught around the world, Father. Let all those who hear it, Father, have a changed heart, Father God. Father God, we pray for Barbara, Father God. You will touch her, Father, and her COVID test will come back negative, Father, so she can go back to work. And Father, we pray for Elder Barry's wife, Father, that you take the pain away from her feet, Father, and let her get back to her own movements, Father. And Father, we just say thank you, Father God. We know that you are washing down upon us, Father. Let me know, Father God, you are our beginning, you are our end. And Father, we know that everything that happens, Father, you hear me in the Father, Father. It's you that's guiding us, carefully, and everything, Father. And we pray for those in harm's way, and it's this hurricane coming through, Father. We pray that it would not harm anyone, Father. We can always buy more property, Father. We can always fix up a property. But you can't replace a life, Father God. So I know, Father God, this word, Father God, will be given, Father, from this pulpit tonight, Father. And let it glorify you, Father, as we see all those things, Father, we need to prepare for, Father, in time, Father God. We know, Father God, that journey in time, Father, must prepare, Father. We pray, Father, that you will look down upon your soul tonight, Father, and let everything be well, Father. And we know, Father God, those who are watching from home, Father, we pray that you will touch them with spirit tonight, Father. Let them hear this word tonight, Father. Let them understand, Father, how important it is. Obey this word to the end, Father. And Father, let us be the new people. faith, Father, to continue on. We need to have the faith to put our lives in your hands, Father, and let you do what you do so well, Father, as to protect your people, Father God. Father, we come today, Father, to serve us, your servant, Father, to come and to give this service, Father God. Holy Spirit, Father, we pray that you will send a spirit tonight, Father, and let it touch each and every one of us, Father God. Oh, Father, we are so grateful, Father God. Oh, we have, Father God. Oh, we have, Father God. We just say thank you, Father God, for all these things, Father God. Father God, again, we thank you for the opportunity to come into your house tonight, Father, and to put this broadcast out to all those that are shut in at home, Father. Father, we pray that as you look down upon this service tonight, Father, you would do it with love, Father, knowing that we are presenting your word to all those that have an ear to hear, Father. And we know, Father, that all we need to do is to have more faith so we can put our lives in your hands, Father. Let you take care of it, Father. Let you guide us through these storms in our life, Father. And Father, we pray for Pastor John tonight as he delivers this word, Father, that you will touch him doubly with the Holy Spirit, Father, and let those words off his tongue, Father, enter into our hearts, Father, and let us cherish these words and keep them, Father. And Father, we pray for all those that are battling the COVID-19 epidemic. We pray for those that have already passed and their families, Father. And we pray for those that have not received it yet that may have it, Father, that all we need to do, Father, is trust in you, Father, and everything will be okay. And Father, we thank you for the first responders, Father, that are continuing to watch over those with the COVID virus, Father, and nursing them back to life, Father. And as we go through this service tonight, Father, we pray that the end time message is received, Father. We're getting close, Father, and we know how important it is to receive the end time word, Father, so we can prepare ourselves, so we're not the chaff that's bound up and thrown into the fire, but we go into the barn as wheat, Father. And all these things we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Scripture reading tonight is Matthew 24:15-16. Therefore, when you see the abomination of desolation spoken of by Daniel the prophet standing in the holy place, whoever reads, let him understand. Then let those who are in Judea flee to the mountains. Amen. The pastor come forward and complete the message started last week. What did Jesus mean when he said, flee to the mountain? That's part two.
Thank you. Minister Don, God bless you, and I welcome all of you to the Bible study tonight, to our prayer meeting. I believe we're living in a time when prayer is needed more than ever before, whether it be for our church, our loved ones, our seminary, wherever, whatever our needs are. We're living, I believe, in the last times. You know, we began this message by asking that rhetorical question, what did Jesus mean when he said, flee to the mountains? Tonight, as I prepare to conclude the message, part two, I want us to understand we need to be like arrows in an archer. We need to have a perfect aim. And our aim should be to go to the mountain, flee to that mountain that Jesus was telling us he wants us to go to. As we conclude the message tonight, as I'm saying, I want to do this in several parts, so I'm giving them in parts so that you might take notes. Big number one, as we head for the conclusion, is that there's a redemptive historical significance of the term mountains and the term mountain in the Holy Scriptures and in the books of redemption history. Mountain, as we learned, already had literal meanings and spiritual. They can relate to many things that are in our way or that block us from going to God and standing before God. Sin could be a mountain that stands before us if we're not careful. But what is the real historical significance of the mountain of God and mountains? Why is the mountains there plural? You know, it's almost like the heavens, isn't it? It's plural. Well, little number one, The mountain represents a place of revelation. The place of revelation. It's a place where God reveals his word, and through his word, he reveals himself. God wants to reveal himself to us through his word. What kind of a word would we have to receive for God to reveal himself to us? It's important we know this. I believe we all want to stand before the Lord in the last days. The Bible says that the 144,000 shall stand before the Lord. But if you'll note clearly, it says they stand on a mountain. And on this mountain, they can hear the voice of God. Very important. You know what? I want you to think about this now. Don't let this point slip you by. It says that, I'll give an example here. While Moses was on the mountain, Mount Sinai, the Bible says that he was speaking to God. He could hear the voice of God. He was meeting with God face to face. But to all those at the foot of the mountain, to all those that merely wanted a relationship with God, they weren't on the mountain. They were at the base of the mountain. And we know what we do when we're at the base of the mountain, don't we? We don't always live in like we should. It says, those at the foot of the mountain, all they could do when they heard God speaking, it was like trumpets sounding. Trumpets sounding. You know, that's so amazing. So amazing. I'm going to just give you, quote two verses. You can read that at a later time. But in Exodus 19, verse 13 and the following, God said that when he spoke to Moses, he spoke to him in a voice. But the people at the foot of the mountain heard it like it sounded like a trumpet. What is the significance of that? Well, Isaiah speaks about that. God told him to lift his voice like a trumpet. But Revelations chapter 4, verse 1, John said, I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day, and I heard the voice of the Lord as if it was a trumpet. Revelation 4, 1. Just simply write that down, okay? Now, do we have a case where this is exposed to us or revealed to us in the Old Testament? Yes. Listen to the next verse we're going to read. We're going to read it on the board here, and it's very important because I want you to compare yourself to Elijah. I believe we are the Elijahs for God in these last days. We're preparing a way for the coming of the Lord. Amen? Elijah was on that mountain, and when he was on that mountain, he could hear things. He saw many things, even a revelation he was given. We're going to be given a revelation in the last days too, the Bible says. When you look at Revelation, you hear that some people are going to hear everything like a trumpet. But some people are going to hear the voice of God. Going to hear the voice of God. When they hear the voice of God, they're going to understand. They're going to receive that malsam, that word. Let's look at 1 Kings chapter 19, verse 11. Now, please, compare this to the revelation when you're reading it, to the mountain of God. Don't let this get by you. Elijah experiences the same things we do during the revelation, or when it comes to the revelation in the end times. Let's read. Then he said, go out and stand on the mountain before the Lord, and behold, the Lord passed by. And a great and strong wind tore into the mountain and broke the rocks in pieces before the Lord. But the Lord was not in the wind. Have you ever seen a wind that was so strong it would break a mountain? That's an awesome wind. Revelation speaks about winds, doesn't it? Revelation 7. The second part of that verse said, and after the wind, Elijah heard an earthquake. He saw an earthquake. But it says, but the Lord was not in the earthquake either. Verse 12, and after the earthquake, a fire. All of these things we find in Revelation. But the Lord was not in the fire. Why is this important? Let's all read this last part together. Read it together. And after the fire, a still small voice. All of these things the Lord was doing, and yet it was here. Elijah saw and heard all these things, and yet he said, I heard a still small voice. When the Spirit of the Lord speaks to us, that's what he speaks to us in, a still small voice. When we really have faith. When Elijah went up to the Mount Horeb, or which is also called Mount Sinai, God revealed the word to him. How? In that small voice. He revealed to him about the plan and about the place, that mountain, where Elijah was going to be transfigured. God gave him that word. We've already learned from Dr. Lee, precious word, how God even gave Elijah nourishment at the brook Cherith, and then later on at the widow's house at Zarephath. All of Elijah's life was a journey towards the Mount of Transfiguration. Battles to be fought, battles to be won, fleeing that had to be done. But God gave Elijah specific instruction concerning his plan for Elijah's last day. We are the Elijah of God. Amen? God gave Elijah not only a word, the Bible says he gave Elijah spiritual food that he needed to eat to finish the final portion of his journey to the Mount of Transfiguration, to the time he was going to be transfigured. Does that Old Testament verse find any place in the New Testament other than Revelation? Yes, it does. In Mark, I'm very sorry, Mark Chapter 8, verses 31 through 38. Mark makes a record of that in the Gospel of Mark. What's God doing there? God is showing us that we too must attain victory, and we find that victory finally on the mountain of God. We can even overcome death if we really think about it. We can be like Abraham, we can be like Elijah if we'll simply go to that mountain where God is leading us. God told Abraham, why is it important that we go to the mountain of God? Why is it important we hear that voice? Because God told Abraham what he was about to do when he was going to judge Sodom and Gomorrah. Genesis 18, verses 17 and the following tell us that. How many of you would like to know, oh, I've got enough faith that God would reveal to me in these last days what he's about to do? I've got loved ones that I want to see God send messengers to. Amen? Abraham said, I've got a nephew and he's got a family there in Sodom, and he interceded for them. You know what I want us to do tonight? This Wednesday night, I want us to pray. I want us to pray for our nation, pray for our church, and pray for our loved ones. That's how real evangelism comes. Let's look at Psalm 14, verse 7. Why is the mountain of God important? Here it is. Oh, that salvation of Israel would come out of Zion. Where does salvation come from? From that mountain. Isaiah 40, verse 9. Let's read that one. O Zion, you who bring good tidings, get up into the high mountains. O Jerusalem, you who bring good tidings, lift up your voice with strength. Lift it up. Be not afraid. Behold your God. Why don't we have to be good? Because we will be in the presence of God. We can behold our God. We can meet with God and see him. That's how important these mountains are. We won't have to be afraid. Little number two, mountains represent a place of faith and repentance. Let me ask you a question. How much faith do you need to truly repent? Abraham's call came. God called Abraham just like he calls you and I. Called him out of the world. But you know something? throughout the rest of Abraham's life, he went through trials and tribulations. He went through hard times and separations. After he met God, even after God made a covenant with him, he still endured hardship. But Abraham was the first man who ever met Melchizedek. Why? Because God provided him revelation. When he gave him that revelation, even in the revelation, there were many difficulties, many trials. But through it all, Abraham received wisdom, and he received faith. He received understanding. He received what he needed through those trials. What was God trying to do, church? He was trying to bless. God wanted to bless Abraham. And God wanted to speak to Abraham about heavenly things, but he couldn't speak to Abraham about heavenly things in the beginning. It was a journey. Elijah had to finish that journey. It comes a time in our life when God can speak to the church about heavenly things. Can I get an amen tonight? Abraham's repentance, his faith, and his wisdom became the very basis that brought about a change in Abraham's life, even where he wanted to dwell, and it became the foundation for God to found his new family, his new house, and his temple. Let's look at 2 Chronicles chapter 3, verse 1. Now Solomon began to build the house of the Lord at Jerusalem on what? Moriah, where the Lord had appeared to his father David, at the place that David had prepared of the threshing floor of Ornan, the Jebusite. Now, sometimes that's pronounced or called Aruna. I know that. This threshing floor of Ornan, though, was the place where King David repented. Repented means he changed. Let me ask you a question. Why a threshing floor? What does anybody do, a landowner, if he owns land and he's collecting a harvest, what does he do at the threshing floor? On the threshing floor, he separates the wheat from the chaff. Luke 22:31-32 says even God was going to build a church. Jesus was going to build a church. And he told Peter, upon this rock I shall build my church. And Peter got proud. Luke 22:31-32, and he said, I'm going to build my church there. What? Upon the faith of Peter. Matthew 13:30 says the same thing. Jesus taught that. All right. Why did David repent at the threshing floor? What does it mean he repented at the threshing floor? Because it was there he had been, it was at that point that he had been thoroughly sifted and tested. Sifted, remember Satan said, he asked Jesus, could he sift him like wheat? The same thing happens on threshing floors. Jesus and the cross represent a place where God also prepared for our repentance. Jesus was sifted too. He was tried. And yet Jesus proved he was good wheat. Amen? Jesus proved he was the firstborn of God. How many believe the church in the last day? You understand, we have to be the firstborn of God. Isaiah 59:20. We will never stand before the Lord if we don't go through this journey, this process. Isaiah 59:20 tells us Jesus is our Redeemer. Begin. The Redeemer will come to Zion. That's where he's coming. And to those who return from transgression in Jacob, says the Lord. Where is he going to? He will come to Zion. Now, where is Zion? It's not a literal mountain. That's what we really need to learn here. When Jesus says, flee to the mountain, he's telling us to flee to the place where Jesus will be, where the Lord's going to be at. You're coming there to meet him. You know what the Bible says there in Isaiah 59:20? He's going to meet us there again. He's coming back there again. What is that place the Lord is coming to. He's coming to a place where the Word of God is being proclaimed. We come to church to meet God also. Have we as a church, have we as a people experienced true repentance and true change? Have we been to the threshing floor of God? Jesus said, when it's time for the harvest. You know, we think about a harvest at the end time. What about some of us need to be harvested right now, like David? We need to be harvested right now. The mountains represent people who have received our Father's heavenly word. In other words, Jesus was a mountain. The word is a mountain. The kingdom of God is a mountain. But we are mountains. We are sons of God. How are we mountains? We are those who have been attained a heavenly realm of faith. We need to attain a faith of a heavenly realm. I've had people in our very church right here say, Pastor, why do we have to keep studying the Word? How much do we have to study the Word? You need to study the Word until you attain this kind of a faith. That's what you're doing. Some people will never do that. Don't just study, but receive it. Hallelujah. We are people who have changed, just like Abraham. We are people who have changed, just like David. We've repented. The mountain of God is a heavenly realm that God wants us all in the last days to go to. The mountain of God represents the new Jerusalem, that new mountain, that new city, that new place. It's a city and a place where the temple of God is going to appear in the last days. Jesus is coming there and he is the temple. Amen? That's a place where the temple is going to be eternally established. Let's look at Psalms 2, verse 6. Begin. Yet I have set my king on my holy hill on Zion. Here it's called a holy hill. Let's look at Micah 4:1, okay? Let's read. Now it shall come to pass in the latter days that the mountain of the Lord's house shall be established on the top of the mountains and shall be exalted above the hills, and peoples shall flow to it. I believe there's people flowing to the mountain from here. Jesus wanted Nicodemus to receive the word about heavenly things. In John 3:12, let's read that. Think about this. You've never thought about it this way before, but think about it right now. God wants you to receive things that you can only receive on the mountain of God. You have to have that kind of a faith. That's kind of word that that Elijah received. Let's read John 3:12. Begin. If I have told you earthly things and you do not believe, how will you believe if I tell you heavenly things? God, Jesus Christ could have told us all kinds of things, but he said, no, we have to wait now until the Father comes. We cannot enter this place until that word comes down from that mountain. And that word has to come from that mountain, so we'll ascend up that mountain. How do we go to that mountain? We follow the word to that mountain. Hallelujah. And there's little mountains that will witness to us about that mountain. But that can't be a good mountain, and it can't be mountains that God wants. Any other mountain, God's going to lower them. Amen. We learned that in Isaiah. But God said, these mountains will tell you how to get to that mountain. Does that make sense? I hope it does. The only way to enter the New Jerusalem, the only way to enter spiritual Jerusalem, is for it to appear before you. It has to be manifest. You have to see it. What do you think the message of Ezekiel's temple is all about? It's a picture of a spiritual temple. It represents Christ and the Father. It represents both. They are God seated on his throne. Glory has filled that temple. And God wants that glory to fill not only a glory on a temple and a mountain, God wants that glory to fill you and me. Hallelujah. That's why it's called Mount Zion. That's where God comes down. That's where he appears. I hope this is blessing you. Ezekiel 20, verse 40. Let's read that. Please read it. Read it to be blessed. For on my holy mountain, on the mountain height of Israel, says the Lord God, there all the house of Israel, all of them in the land shall serve me. There I will accept them, and there I will require your offerings and the first fruit of your sacrifices together with all your holy things. See, God wants us to give us all of our holy things. That's our fruit. That's our life. May we have holy fruit. It says, I will require offerings and first fruit of your sacrifices together with all your holy things. Now let's read Ezekiel 40, verse 2. Please read together. In the visions of God, he took me into the land of Israel, and he set me on a very high mountain. On it towards the south was something like the structure of a city. See, this is something that's being made manifest. You know, this is not on the text tonight, but don't you think about this. Ezekiel was given, he saw that he was given a rod, and he saw a man measuring the temple, didn't he? Why do we measure, church? Why do you think we measure something? Is it just so we'll know how big it is? How wide it is? How thick it is? We measure it so we'll appreciate it. We measure it so we'll know how valuable it is. How valuable is this word? How valuable is it understanding about this mountain? How valuable is this revelation God is giving you and me today? Hallelujah. It's valuable. That's why we study Ezekiel's temple. It's about the New Jerusalem and the mountain of God. Kesan ban hebanandel. You have to, there's a reason why you measure. I hope you understand the value of the words you're receiving. The description of the New Jerusalem is a spiritual description. Let's read Revelations 21, verse 10. This proves what I'm saying. Revelation 21, 10, let's read that and be blessed. And he carried me away in the spirit to a great and high mountain and showed me a great city, the holy Jerusalem. And where did it come from? Out, come down out of heaven, just like Jesus, just like the Word. The Word has to come down from the mountain so we can come back up it. Ezekiel's river, it flows down from the temple, down the mountain. It's a temple where the city of peace, the peace of God, will be established. That river will be there forever and ever. It's called the River of Life. I don't know why I'm coughing. Number three. This is the mountain where the word of God will go forth in the end times. Let's look at Isaiah 2, verse 2. Let's read that quickly and together. Now it shall come to pass in the latter days that the mountain of the Lord's house shall be established on the top of the mountain. See, it's the Lord's house. And shall be exalted above the hills. There we go. And all nations shall flow to it. Many people shall come and say, let us go up to the mountain of the Lord, to the house of the God of Jacob. He will teach us his ways, and we shall walk in his paths. Now let's read this together. For out of Zion shall go forth the law, and the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. The word comes out of Jerusalem. The word's coming out of this church. Let's look at, why is this important? Because in the Revelation says there's coming a famine. Amos 8:11. Let's read that. Behold, the days of the Lord are coming, says the Lord, that I will send a famine on the land, not a famine of bread, nor a thirst for water, but for the hearing of the words of the Lord. Why is there a famine? Because you get all you hear is trumpets. We keep talking about the trumpets. We need to hear the voice of God, hear the word of God, go to the mountain of God, and we don't have to worry about trumpets. Can I get an amen? Amen. Beloved church, God knew that Elijah was hungry. God knew that Elijah had become weak and tired. God knows that when we're weak and tired. This is why God led him to Mount Horeb. This is why God fed him there. If God had not fed Elijah, he would have never went and been transfigured. We've got to be fed that word, Isaiah 25:6. There will surely come a famine of the word for all who do not go to this mountain. Look here, if you don't go to that mountain, you're going to get hungry. Remember we learned the last week, if we go to the mountain of God, it's called Jehovah Jireh. What does that mean? God will provide for us. You could be in a desert and God will provide for you, but you need to go to the mountain. Hallelujah. Without this word, without this kind of a faith, true worship is virtually non-existent. That's why there's a famine. Without the word, you can't have true worship. The world will become a place of tribulation, famine, hardship like someone has never known ever before. But for those who go to the mountain of God, say that with me. For those who go to the mountain of God, they shall be nourished. Hallelujah. Let's look at Isaiah 59:20 once more. The Redeemer will come to Zion, and those who turn from transgressions in Jacob, says the Lord. Can you see the abomination of desolation standing in the holy place today? I asked that last week. Jesus is saying, if you see the abomination, start going, start fleeing, start looking for that mountain. How? That's what we need to conclude. Well, to go to that mountain, we need to take something with us. Let's read Hosea 14:2. Take words with you and return to the Lord. Say to him, take away all my iniquity and receive us graciously that we may present what? The fruit of our lips. From your lips you can produce fruit. Tell somebody about the Lord. Tell them about the mountain of God. It's time for us to make our way to the mountains. Amen? You know what? Senior pastor said, please don't try to pack bags. Don't try to pack your own bags. Because those earthly garments won't do you any good. You need to worry about spiritual garments. Can I get another amen? Amen. Don't take any extra luggage with you. Senior pastor, everywhere we went, used to go for a week, we'd have to take a little tiny bag. Don't try to take your own food either. God made sure Israel ran out of food when he brought them out of Egypt. And then trust the Lord and he'll provide for you. God will make it a mountain where he's with you, whether it's a desert or any other place. It doesn't have to be a literal mountain. How are you going to go there? You're going to follow the word. You're going to follow the stream. You're going to look for that source of food, where you won't experience a famine. How do we found that mountain? We follow the stream, that river that flows from Ezekiel's temple. It's on the mountain. Now, how long are you going to follow that river? Until you can meet with him. What kind of a faith do you have to meet with the Lord? They stood in front of Jesus, but they could not meet the Lord. Let's look at 1 Kings 19:31. The Bible says, the remnant shall gather there. Please repeat after me. The remnant shall gather there. What are the remnants? 1 Kings 19:31. Let's read it together. For out of Jerusalem shall go a remnant, and those who escape from Mount Zion, the zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this. See, it's God's zeal that's going to do it, not yours. But it says, the remnant will escape You remember how Elijah thought he was the only one left? He fought Jezebel and all of them. He said, I'm the only one left, God. That's, sometimes we think we're the only ones, only a few. That's not true. Let's look at Isaiah 4:3. And it shall come to pass that he who is left in Zion and remains in Jerusalem will be called holy. Everyone who is recorded among the living in Jerusalem, I want to be recorded, don't you, is living. For when the Lord has washed away the filth of the daughters of Zion and purged the blood of Jerusalem from her midst, by the spirit of judgment and by the spirit of burning, verse 5, then the Lord will create above every dwelling place of Mount Zion, above all of her assemblies, a cloud and a smoke by day and a shining and a flaming of light by fire by night. For over all the glory there will be a covering, and there will be a tabernacle for shade in the daytime for heat, and a place of refuge and shelter from the storm and rains. I want that shelter, don't you? Let's look at Revelation 14:1. Where are they going to gather? Begin. Then I looked, and behold, a lamb standing on Mount Zion, and with him 144,000, having his Father's name written on their foreheads. We need the Father's name written on our foreheads. Who are these? Those who follow the word to the end will stand with the Father, stand with him on Mount Zion. He's not coming as the Son. He's coming in the glory of the Father. Number 5, it's a place of final victory and celebration. How many of you really want to eat at the table of the Lord in the last days? I do. If we really want to eat the food that is good, remember Eve, she wanted to eat the fruit that was good. If we want to eat a food that is good, we have to eat the food of God. We have to go there to that mountain to eat it. Let's read Isaiah 25, verse 6. Begin. And in this mountain, the Lord of hosts will make for all the people a feast of choice pieces, a feast of wine on the lees, of fat things of full marrow, of well-refined wine on the lees. And he will destroy on this mountain the surface of the covering cast over all the people and the veil that spread over all the nations. Listen, verse 8. And he will swallow up death forever, and the Lord God will wipe away tears from every face. And the rebuke of his people he will take away from all the earth, for the Lord has spoken. Church, that defines right there what Revelation 21, verse 3 tells us. Let's read Revelation 21, verse 3. It says the same thing. And I heard a loud voice from heaven saying, behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people, and God himself will be with them, and he will be their God. If you read that on, it goes on to say there'll be no more crying, no more tears, nothing. Where? On that mountain. Hebrews 12, verses 18 through 20. Let's read that. We're not going to read all of it, but I want you to see that. Write it down. Hebrews 12, 18 through 20. It says, we've not come to a mountain that can be touched. It can't be burned with fire. Verse 19 says, and the sound of the trumpet and the voice of the word, so that those who heard it begged that the word that it should not be spoken to them anymore. For they could not endure what was commanded. And it was so much as the beast touches the mountain, it shall be stoned and shot with an arrow. What does that mean? Beast cannot go to that mountain. Let's look at Hebrews 12, 24. Hebrews 12, 22 through 24. Begin. But you have come to Mount Zion, and to the city of the living God. See, it's a city, isn't it? The heavenly Jerusalem, to an innumerable company of angels, to the general assembly and the church of the firstborn. See, it's telling us on that mountain, the church of the firstborn is going to be there, who are registered in heaven. I want to be registered in heaven, don't you, church? To God, the judge of all, to all the spirits of just men made perfect. I want to be made perfect, and God will make me perfect by his word. To Jesus, the mediator of a new covenant, and to the blood of sprinkling that speaks better than the blood of Abel. Let's read Hebrews 12:26. I'm headed for the finish line. Whose voice then shook the earth, but now he has promised, saying, yet once more, not only the earth, but I will also shake heaven. You know, Mount Zion is a mountain that cannot be shaken, church. Mount Zion cannot be shaken. We need to go to that mountain. We need to go to that church. We need to drink that water. We need to find that word, that river. I believe we're living in, we've joined a church. We're in a church that cannot be shaken, because we're a church of God's true firstborn, just like Jesus Christ. We might be sifted, but we're firstborn. Hallelujah. The Bible says Israel shook greatly when they felt the earthquake at Mount Sinai. Exodus 19:18. Let's read that. Now Mount Sinai was completely in smoke, because the Lord descended upon it in fire. Its smoke ascended like the smoke of a furnace, and the whole mountain quaked greatly. Was Moses afraid on the mountain? No. Israel at the foot of the mountain shook and was afraid. Let's go to the mountain. Amen? We're going to a mountain that can't be shaken. Hebrews 12:27. Let's read that and let's believe that. Begin. Now this, yet once more, indicates the removal of those things that are being shaken, as of things that are made, that are things which cannot be shaken may remain. Therefore, since we are receiving a kingdom which cannot be shaken, let us have grace by which we may serve God acceptably with reverence and godly fear. Don't fear the world, fear God if you're going to fear something. Hebrews 12:25, church. See that you do not refuse him who speaks. That's the key right there. Do not refuse him who speaks. For if they did not escape who refused him who spoke on earth, much more shall we not escape if we turn away from him who speaks from heaven. See, the mountain symbolizes heaven. The mountain, I said last week, is the highest place on this earth, the pinnacle, the peak. We're on the earth, but we're in heaven. We're on the mountain. We're in the New Jerusalem. When in these last days that's going to happen? Let's read verse 26. Whose voice then shook the earth, but now he has promised, saying, yet once more I shall shake not only the earth, but also the heavens. If you're in the heavens, you better be in the third heaven. So you cannot be shaken. Amen? Be on the right mountain. Listen to the right mountains. There's mountains that will corrupt you. Listen carefully. The senior pastor said, going to the mountain is one thing. Climbing that mountain is another. Reach the peak and pinnacle of your faith. How? Study the word more and more and more. Let's read Psalms 15, verses 1 through 5. Begin. Lord, who may abide in your tabernacle? Who may dwell in your holy hill? He who walks uprightly and works righteousness, speaks truth in his heart. He does not backbite with his tongue, nor does evil to his neighbor, nor does he take a reproach against a friend. Verse 4. In whose eyes a vile person is despised, but he honors those who fear the Lord. Do you honor those who fear the Lord? He who swears to his own hurt and does not change. Once you change, truly repent, you don't change anymore. He who does not put out his money for usury, nor does he take a bribe against the innocent. He who does these things shall never be moved. That's what the Word of God says in Psalms 15, 1, verse 5. How many believe God really is going to gather a remnant at the end? What is the remnant? It's those that have been shaken, but they're the wheat, they're not the chaff. They're those that are like Christ, like Elijah. People who have this kind of a faith cannot be shaken, and they will certainly, certainly gather to the Lord in the last days. They'll gather on his mountain. They'll follow the word to his mountain. Psalms 24, verse 3. Let's read that. Who may ascend into the hill of the Lord, or who may stand in his holy place? He who has clean hands and a pure heart, who has not lifted up his soul to an idol, nor sworn deceitfully. Verse 5, he shall receive a blessing from the Lord and righteousness from the God of his salvation. This is a generation of those who seek him, who seek your face. Are you seeking the face of the Lord? You have to go to the mountain to see the face of God. Revelation 14, verse 4. Revelation 14, 4. Let's read together and be blessed. These are the ones who were not defiled with women, for they're virgins. These are the ones who follow the Lamb wherever he goes. These were redeemed from among men, being first fruits to God and to the Lamb. If you're confused about who the Lamb and God is, who the Son is, he's the same as the Father. Same thing. I pray that we could find great victory. I pray that we could find the faith we need. I pray that we could move to the mountains and go to the mountain and stand with and only with God, the only God, and the only one who can help you in the last days. Clothes won't help you. Money won't help you. Food you can take with you won't help you. One day, you're going to have to trust in God to provide for you. And I promise you, he'll do it on that mountain. But it's not a literal mountain. That mountain will be with you wherever you go. Hallelujah. Let's go to the mountain of the Lord. Let's pray. Most gracious, loving Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for this precious word. Father God, we understand that no beast shall ever ascend that mountain. Beast may have went to the mountains during the days of Noah, but they shall not go to that mountain in these last days. Father God, no beast shall enter the New Jerusalem. No beast shall enter your rest, but they'll hear the trumpets, Father. Father God, may we hear more than trumpets. May we hear your precious voice. I ask this blessing upon all the members of the Covenant of the Torch Church. In Jesus' name, amen. Beloved church, let's do hymn number 88. Aren't you glad he's your friend? Let him know it. I have found a friend in Jesus. He's everything to me. The fairest of 10,000 tame my soul. He's the lily of the valley. In him alone I see. He's a family in me. Make my family whole. Rural family's comfort in trouble. He's my stay. He's a total very comfort role. He's the lily of the valley, that bright and morning star. He's the fairest of 10,000 save my soul. He is all my grief has taken, and all my sorrow. He is temptation, he's my only power. I am all for him forsaken, and all my eyes. I'm hardened now, he keeps my by his power. Hallelujah! Though all the world forsakes me, and Satan tempts me sore, though Jesus I shall faithfully preach my goal. Alien, he's the lily of the valley, that bright and morning star. He's the fairest of 10,000 angels. Hallelujah! He will never, never leave me, nor forsake me. He'll live by faith and through his blessed will. A wall of fire about me, I've nothing now to fear. He's the battle. Amen. Though sweeping up to glory to see his blessed face. I cannot follow that. He's the lily of the valley, that bright and morning star. He's the fairest of 10,000, save my soul. Amen? Amen. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Brother Mary.
Father God, as we now come before you with our tithes and offerings, Father. Father, we have prepared them with thought, Father, with love, for this precious word. And Father, we ask that you will bless those tonight that have paid their tithes and offerings given to you, Father, but also bless those that could not, Father. For we know there's many out there that are having hard times, Father. We ask that you will watch over them and bless them also, Father. And Father, as we present these to you tonight, Father, we pray that it will be pleasing to you, Father, as we lift them up, as we give them to you, Father, to do as you will. Show us, guide us, and direct us in your ways, Father, not ours. And all these things I pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Most gracious, loving Heavenly Father, we've come, we've worshiped. Father, we've praised you. We've offered you, Father, first the fruit of our lips. Precious Father, we ask you now that you look upon this worship service, that you receive the service, you receive our praise, now you receive our gifts, our offerings, our tithes, Father. Receive them, Father. May they be acceptable in your sight. May they bring glory to your name. May you enable us, Father, to proclaim your word of redemption history to all the world. We ask this blessing, Father, that your word would flow forth. In Jesus' name, amen. I just wanted to briefly share with you one moment, if I could, that the sixth book of redemption history will be coming out very soon. We found out today. It's CLC is the one who has published it, but it's being printed in Korea. Book 7 will be coming out soon after, and we'll be announcing that here in the coming weeks. Evangelist Sophie and I have been having kind of rapture practice about that all day today. So be thinking about that. Also, we want to remind you of how you can tithe to us online by using a program called Cash App. If you don't have that, you can see it on our bulletins. You can see it on our website. You can even scan it so you can take you directly to the right account where you can make your contribution by your phone or what have you. Whatever way you use to contribute. Please support us, and let's make the proclamation of redemption history a reality from the Covenant of the Torch Church. Can I ask you to do that? Thank you. God bless you. Let's rise. Let's sing hymn number 1, and let's conclude our service tonight. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above the heavenly host. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, may the love of our God and Father be with us. May we meet you on that mountain, Father. And may the fellowship, the indwelling, the fullness of the Holy Spirit come into every heart, dwell in every home. Father, make us truly your temples. Father, that we might dwell with you on your mountain forever. From now, forever, and evermore. Amen. This concludes our worship service, and thank you, and God bless you.